Well, the Masters is part of snooker's Triple Crown and is celebrating its 40th year this year. And as always, it's an exclusive London party that is by invitation only.
Can I come in?
Sorry, Ken, if your name's not down, you're not coming in.
Oh.
Nothing I can do.
Who is going to pull this out of the bag?
John Spencer was our very first master, defeating Ray Reardon in a black ball finish in 1975 at the West Centre Hotel.
It's a great one.
Setting a precedent for nail-biting drama and tension that has been repeated time and time again.
The following year, the Masters moved to the new London Theatre in Drury Lane before transferring in 1979 to the Wembley Conference Centre, a venue we can all agree was one of the finest we've ever played in.
Wonderful setting for a wonderful tournament.
It was fabulous.
Incredible.
Brilliant, brilliant.
Absolutely magic.
We used to have lots of flowers around the side. They always made it look pretty. Like one, I think one year a giant wasp came out and I was like thinking, please look, I don't really like TV, like running away from this wasp on TV.
It was like a circle, a complete circle. The one table set up.
Best playing arena, really. I mean, you know, the atmosphere there, especially at a final or a semi or if you played Jimmy, it was just like crazy, you know.
I got a lot of huge support from the London audience, like Ronnie O'Sullivan does. And I think it's because of the way we play the game. You know, the Conference Centre was probably one of the best venues ever.
South Africa's Perry Mans was the first man to win at Wembley, and those early years were memorable for the colourful characters and costumes as each year a new master was crowned. 9 different champions in its first 10 years. The only man to win it twice, Alex Hurricane Higgins. And then in 1984, a semi-final for the ages.
This is where he wants a little bounce off the cushion.
And the event's first maximum, courtesy of Kerr.
Get in! Lovely! Super!
That was a very special match because Kurt's brilliant on 4-7 and I potted a few flare shots that went in.
Jimmy eventually won the match and the next day claimed his sole Masters title, playing a brand of snooker never seen before and prompting Jack Carnham to make up a new word to describe it.
Well, words escape me, just fantabulous.
I saw a puff of the cheeks then.
Until Ding Junhui's 147 at the 2011 Masters, Kirk's remained the one and only Masters maximum, although others have come agonisingly close.
I'd like to be nearer this pink. Oh, the disappointment!
It's probably one of the only times in snooker you are thinking about the prize. You know, at the start of the break, you're thinking, oh, chance of a maximum, and you know, what are you going to do? You can get this yellow sports car that was always out in the foyer in the venue, so there is that little that's always at the back of your mind, the prize, and that's the only thing, only time in snooker you ever think about sort of material things.
Wow, would you believe it? 140 and the same.
Oh, still gives me nightmares. I almost want to drive a man to drink. Let's move on, shall we? In 1985 and 1986, Cliff Thorburn became the first man to win back-to-back titles, and in the process, established himself as the first three-time winner. And then the following year, 1987, saw the first of what was become a master staple, the stirring comeback.
It's never over till it's over.
Dennis Taylor, like a phoenix rising from the ashes.
I was 8-5 down. I just heard Alex's manager ordering champagne to celebrate Alex winning his first title for 2 years. And he probably would have won that if I hadn't heard that, because I come back into the arena and it just put that little bit of fire that you need in your belly, a little bit of killer instinct. So
uh, There must be a little leprechaun in that bucket to keep the cue ball out.
The atmosphere in the last frame was just incredible. I managed to beat Alex in the deciding frame, and that's one of the greatest wins of my career.
1988, when the player still posed for the cameras before play got underway, was the first and still only whitewash in a Masters final, as Steve Davis defeated Mike Hallett 9-0. Incredibly enough, though, that's probably not even Mike's worst Masters memory. We'll get to that soon enough as we look back on the Hendrynasty, a surely never to be repeated run of success.
And Stephen Hendry, the new Masters champion, the youngest champion ever. 21-year-old Stephen Hendry, Benson Hedges Master from 1990. Yeah!
Come back. Keep thinking the law of averages, I'm going to get beat, but I'm just keep hoping that I don't.
He gets to keep the trophy.
A master indeed.
England have been given a major trophy to keep, so great times. The Masters, being the top player in the world, I always felt I had to prove that I was the best player in the world. I always felt when I got there, the World Championship was your first aim in every season, but the Masters was always the second one for me, even above the UK, because it was a chance to prove I was the best player in the world against the other 15 guys as well. I was obviously a red-hot favourite, I was a world number one, so it was a shock to the system to be 7-0 down. I just sensed a bit of agitation, a bit of desperation about him, and I just thought if we could just one frame at a time.
I must admit, looks as if Mike Hallett is fated to lose this final.
When I won it, I showed a bit more emotion than I usually do.
Yeah! The great comeback. Mike Hallett led 7-0 and 8-2. He was within two pots of winning 9-2. But Stephen Hendry, world champion that he is, hung on and hung on and hung on and has won by 9-8.
I was the number one player in the world and those were the tournaments that I felt belonged to me. Just went down expecting to win every year. It was a nice feeling.
1995, and for the first time in 7 years, there wasn't someone called Henry in the final. Instead, two young men embarking on a rivalry that has lasted for the best part of 20 years.
Personally, I thought John was the best all-round player, and I still do think he's the best all-round player by a mile. I just thought he was going to go on and do a Henry.
This was the first of three consecutive finals for the Rocket, although he'd be beaten the following year by Henry and in 1997 by the Nugget in a final that's always remembered for this.
Streaker. Yeah, I remember that. Yeah, nightmare that was. Crazy. Yeah, interesting. It was 4-all, then I went 8-4 up, didn't miss the ball for 4 frames, and I was like, lovely, I thought I'd won it then. And I come out and I remember Davis played brilliant. I was like, what's going on here? And he just froze me out.
Well, 1998 was the year of the famous re-spotted black. Have you got over it yet, Stephen?
That's in, is it?
No!
It didn't feel like a violent twitch when it left with the cue ball left the tip of my cue. It felt all right, the action. But obviously, I managed to sneak a little bit of side on it and pull the white across and missed it. So. Yeah, I think the least we talk about that, the better.
We'll draw a veil over the next 2 years. That's me sat in my chair. And that's John waving after beating me 10-8. And that's Matthew Stevens winning in 2000, minutes after my 147. That never was.
2001 and the arrival on the scene of the comeback kid, Paul Hunter.
Well, that was the year of Plan B, trailing 6-2 after the afternoon session. Paul returned in the evening, rejuvenated.
Two successive centuries. And that's brought this audience on its feet and to life. Brilliant.
4 centuries in 6 frames to eventually win 10-1. following year in the final against Mark Williams. He staked the Welshman to a 5-0 lead before coming back again to win 10-9. And 2 years later, he trailed Ronnie by 7-2 before winning that one in a decider. That's a whole lot of them.
What a remarkable, brave, courageous performance as he wins his third Masters title once again by 10-9.
I think Paul was just inspired by the crowd and the whole, you know, prestige of the event. And, you know, he beat me fair and square.
Hold hand down, ladies and gentlemen.
For him, the scoreline was irrelevant, really, in some ways. You know, he just kept playing the same way, whether he was 5-0 up, 5-0 down, which is a great attitude to have.
There followed two consecutive finals between O'Sullivan and Higgins. The first, a run for the rocket.
He's played off the jaw in the middle pocket to retain position for the pink. And now just the back to put the seal on a superb performance. Well played, Ronnie O'Sullivan.
The second, a classic.
The adrenaline is running. The match is on a knife edge.
To this day, I don't know how it went in.
But I remember one ball was just on the edge and I thought, and it dropped, right? And John's the type of player who kind of would clear up under that extreme pressure, and he did.
I had a tricky double. Mm-hmm. The double wasn't the shot, because it wasn't like a straight double. But I just decided with a red falling in like that, maybe it was fate, and I took the double on and went in. And it was just
a fantastic clearance.
In 2007, the walls of the Conference Centre came tumbling down and the Masters moved next door into the vastness of the arena, where there was nowhere to hide for a young Ding Junhui, demolished in the final by Ronnie.
I just remember feeling for him, you know, because he was a young boy from another country, you know, it can be a lonely place, and, you know, just the human nature and instinct comes out in you that you just want to care for him. I really liked him a lot, you know, and I've met his family and stuff like that, so, you know, it was more important for me that he was okay than winning that title that year. Snooker didn't mean nothing then when I see that happening to him.
But if Ronnie became a little bit sympathetic towards Ding, he was about to be embroiled in another classic rivalry that had a little bit more spice. Prost Senna, Ali Foreman, McEnroe Borg, O'Sullivan, Selby. Mark Selby was already a Masters champion when the two men met in the 2009 final. Ronnie emerged victorious, but the following year, the jester would get his revenge.
He may attempt the double to clinch this year's Masters.
It's right in the middle of the pocket.
I call him a torturer. He's kind of tortured a few opponents, you know, and I've quite, you know, it's been nice sitting back watching them go through it as well, you know, because a lot of people can be critical and think, you know, oh, Ronnie's cracked up, this and that. But until you actually play someone like Mark and go through it, you know, you don't really realise what's going on out there sometimes.
Ronnie's got his opinion. I mean, obviously, he's a fantastic player, but not everyone is as naturally gifted as Ronnie. Obviously, everyone's got their own style, and this seems to be my style. Obviously, it's still working, so I'm not going to change it.
Jimmy Young.
This is a tournament that's had it all. Is it any surprise that it's loved by the fans and players alike? Well, here's to the next 40.
How long will I love you? As long as stars are above you. Longer if I can. How long will I need you? As long as the seasons need to follow their plan. How long will I be with you? As long as the sea is bound to wash upon the sand. Stars above you.
And Paul Hunter will always